Hello and onegai shimasu. Some might say that I'm a master of karate. Others would say that I'm still a beginner. Either way, I'm definitely still learning. So, what does my belt really mean? That's what I'm here to find out. When I introduce myself to fellow karateka, I'm a shodan, or first dan, student of Goju Ryu. But non-martial artists usually don't recognize those terms. If I'm talking to someone else, I just call myself a black belt. And we all know what a black belt is, right? Namely, that I know all of karate, and I could take anyone, except another black belt, in a fight. Just kidding, it's more complicated than that. But the belt ranking system encourages us to think in terms of who could beat whom, whose skill level is higher, who is the best at karate. And I think the art is poorly served by that kind of discussion. So let's take a deeper look at the belt ranking system to see what it's all about. My favorite story to tell in the dojo is that way back in the day, karate had two ranks, the equivalent of white and black belts nowadays. You either knew karate, or you didn't. Back then, people also trained in their street clothes, so you couldn't tell at a glance who was a fighting master and who was a novice. The invention of the ranking system is credited to Kano Jigoro, who is also credited with inventing the art of judo by combining jujitsu, a grappling technique, with aikijutsu, the samurai skill that has been adopted to the modern art of aikido. Kano-sensei established two types of rank. The Q ranks are the beginning ranks, represented by white or colored belts, though Kano-sensei initially only used a white belt for these ranks. These ranks start with higher numbers and progress to lower numbers. After passing through Q, Kano-sensei awarded black belts for the dan ranks. These begin at first dan and go upwards. These two types of rank might have been inspired by the system which Go players use to rank their skill. Fun fact. While there is no upper limit to Kano-sensei's original system, in practice, no judoka or karateka have achieved a rank above 10th dan, which is itself incredibly rare. Karate adopted this system of ranking when it was brought to the Japanese mainland and the school systems, primarily due to the influence of Funakoshi Gichin and Itosu Anko-sensei, along with other masters of the time. Part of this change was aesthetic, designed to make karate seem more Japanese and appeal to the mainlanders who were distrustful of Okinawa. However, the Japanese Dai Nippon Butoku Kai, an organization for the preservation, standardization, and promulgation of martial arts, was key in influencing karate to adopt the ranking system. When Okinawan senseis registered their arts with the organization, they standardized belt ranks and named some previously unnamed styles. Now that we know where the ranking system comes from, we can look at what some of the more common ones are. Though Kano-sensei only used white and black belts, modern dojos have introduced all manner of ranks so that students can track their progress. Most dojos that I've visited have a lot in common. White belts are reserved for the first rank, sometimes even before you've earned a Q rank. A black belt also universally represents a dan rank, though some karateka approach being a black belt a little differently, which I'll cover more in depth later in this video. Very common intermediate ranks include green and brown, usually in that order, while some schools add ranks like purple, blue, and yellow belts in between those. While these belts make for many ranks between beginning martial arts training and reaching black belt, some dojos add even more ranks for one reason or another. In addition to more colored belts, many schools use colored stripes or belts that have more than one color as a way of denoting further progress between solid belt colors. Moreover, some dojos indicate higher dan ranks by adding stripes, usually red, to the black belt. So now I want to go over some of the reasons why the ranking system helps students and dojos. One of the first and most recognizable of these, to me at least, is that the belt system makes students feel like they're improving. I've trained with a lot of people who've missed promotions, even though they were making tangible improvements in their skill, and got frustrated as a result. Even if you're improving, having a new color of fabric around your waist feels like a recognition of the work that you've put in. This is especially important for children, who often have shorter attention spans, which is why many dojos, including my home dojo, have introduced extra ranks specifically for children in between the solid color ranks, to keep them engaged. Another benefit is that ranking can help to standardize the curriculum within a dojo. A green belt, for instance, is guaranteed to know everything that's expected for whatever belt comes before green belt. In a future video, I'm going to talk about a key part of the dojo system, which is senior students assisting their juniors. But for now, I just want to mention that with a ranking system like many dojos have, it can be easy to tell who ranks where and who you can look for to be a mentor. The last big point I want to mention is that many dojos ascribe symbolism to their belt's colors, which, just like the aesthetic of a karateka I mentioned in my video about why we wear the gi, can be a psychological benefit to your training. One school that I've trained with gives their symbolism as follows. A student starts with a white belt, and then, after training a while, it gets stained with grass and slowly becomes green. After this, they train on the mat a little, roll around, and it gets stained with blood, which mixes with the green to form purple. From there, they train outside in the mud, and the mud stains the belt until it becomes brown. Finally, after training for long enough and mixing all of these various stains together, it becomes black, as a symbol of all the dedication that they've put into their art. Many karateka also take pride in wearing their belts, especially their black belts, until they start to fray, or until they start to wear and become worn down, and then eventually proceed back to white, where they can start all over again. They feel that this shows their perseverance in a special way that not wearing a belt wouldn't be able to match. Now, though, I want to look at a few criticisms of the ranking system. So there's a term that I hadn't really heard until I started delving into martial arts YouTube, mikdojo. There are a lot of good explanations of what a mikdojo is or isn't, and I'll link to one in a card now. But the simplest explanation is that they're dojos that are more concerned with providing their students with products to consume than they are with providing actual good training. The more ranks in any given dojo's ranking system, the more times that the dojo can sell you a new physical belt, or the more times the dojo can sell you training programs that are expressly designed to put you through the ranks faster than you otherwise would. This can cheat a student out of good training in exchange for money by selling them on the idea of a new rank rather than actual improvement. Also, the student who achieves a black belt like this may have not achieved as much as other black belts in other dojos, or even might not be at the same rank as lower belts, and might find, if they move to another dojo, that they're shocked that not only can they not go toe-to-toe with the other black belts in that dojo, but they're even lower in ability than some of the colored belt or lower rank students. The other big problem with this system is that no two dojos really have the same system of belts, unless they're run by the same organization, and therefore ranks don't really translate well between dojos. The best example of this phenomenon is that different dojos view the rank of black belt differently. Many dojos view a black belt as a symbol of mastery, of proof that you know all or most of your style. However, even within dojos that are nominally the same style, one black belt might know more or fewer forms than another, even if their dan rank is different, and it's possible that someone at a lower rank can be a more accomplished martial artist than someone at a higher dan rank from a different school. Other dojos still take the opinion that a black belt is just meant to demonstrate that you've achieved the minimum knowledge of your style to be considered proficient. Further black belt training is to polish, expand, and improve your training. The saying goes, black belt isn't the end of your training, it's the beginning. Black belts from these types of schools might not have the same amount of knowledge of forms or knowledge of kata as black belts from other dojos, but almost certainly they've learned how to expand, interpret, and teach themselves so that they can further polish their art. Okay, time for the opinions. Now, first off, this is just what I personally think, and I'm not saying that other people's opinions are wrong. Don't just follow what I say. If you're a black belt, or if you're an aspiring sensei, or if you want to start a dojo, or coming into a new dojo, think for yourself about what ranking system works best for you, your students, and your style. Firstly, though, I do think that we do need a ranking system. Especially in the United States, the colored ranking system that we have right now would be very hard to get rid of. But even if there's another method, there has to be a system to show which students are senior or junior to other students. One of my senseis once told me a story of his 10 years training in Okinawa, where the only belt colors that the dojo awarded were white and black, but your rank in the dojo was determined by a board that had all of the students' names on it. Personally, I think this is a neat idea, but whether it's practical or not in any specific situation is up to the individual dojo and the individual sensei to decide. However, the biggest thing with ranks is that you have to teach students that ranks don't constitute improvement, they're merely markers to show achievement. Take the example of a student who shows up to promotions, who is progressing from one belt to another. In terms of skill, there's no difference between a student attending promotions before and after she receives her new belt. The actual improvement happened while she trained, not during the belt ranking ceremony. Finally, I do think that black belts shouldn't be considered as full mastery because, well, there's no such thing. You can always get better no matter how much you know. Certain styles don't award black belts at all. Their highest rank is navy blue, an indication that while this practitioner knows a lot of the art, there is always more they can learn and improve. Once you've made it to black belt, you know all the basics of your style, and you're ready to start applying them and building on them. In that way, it's kind of like a bachelor's degree. And I also really can't let this go without mentioning a slightly controversial opinion, which is that I don't really think that students who are children should be able to earn a black belt. All the physical skills and techniques that you learn at age 13 don't necessarily translate to being able to do the same techniques at the age of 20, or 30, or even older than that. Since puberty is such a period of rapid change, both in the minds and in the bodies of the children, there's no real way that you can be said to have fully mastered your art when you haven't mastered it in the body that you're going to be spending the rest of your life with. However, I do think that students who have worked hard who are still technically children should be recognized for their hard work. And in fact, I think probationary black belts, like the one that I held for a year before I moved on to my full first dan rank, are a really good way to kind of bridge this gap and recognize the achievement while at the same time recognizing that the knowledge isn't exactly the same as an adult black belt would have. But that's just my opinion. What do you think? What is the best ranking system and why is it useful? Is there even one best ranking system, or do they have to fit different needs in different dojos? Leave your friendly comments down below and check the doobly-doo for the links and sources that I used while putting together this script. And as always, train hard and arigato gozaimashita.